So these delusions had to be understood and applied. That took quite beautiful era of my life, and I started using these delusions extensively. Similarly, the idea of Thuja, everybody knows, made of glass. But a patient doesn't come and say, I am made of glass. Have you ever heard anybody coming and saying, listen, made of glass? No, this is a symbolism. How Thuja will express? He says, listen, doctor, slightest food, you know, disturbs me. Please don't give me higher potency because I cannot bear it. So what is the rubric actually is, delusion, he is delicate. Delusion, he is brittle. These are rubrics in Thuja. So the made of glass has to be understood. That way we try to understand each of these delusions. This was a very, very interesting phase, and it helped us to understand so many remedies so nicely. Okay, go next. Next. So a basic delusion is that which explains the whole of the patient's expressions and feelings. And if you could identify the delusion, the remedy was easier. Go next. Then I created what is called a situational materia medica out of this delusion, which means it is an imaginary situation that would justify the entire expression of a given remedy. For example, the symptom of stramonium, alone in the wilderness, alone in a jungle, alone in a desert, in the night, what is the experience? So that delusion explains all the fear of alone, fear of night, desire light, desire company, fear of animals, fear to be attacked, fear to be devoured, delusion, injury, about to receive, escape, desire to, the entire phenomena of stramonium can be explained with just this situation. You are in the middle of the jungle at night. You can understand stramonium. So that's how I created situational materia medica. And I wrote about it in my book, The Soul of Remedies. I wrote 100 remedies and how they look at reality. And this was a very big step, because so far homeopathy always described how the patient of the remedy looks. Naxomica is fastidious, Lachesis is loquacious, Platina is very haughty, right? Objective. Whereas I tried to look at it from the other way, not how the remedy looks, but how does the patient of the remedy look towards the world? How does he perceive? So I just reversed the equation from objective to subjective, and that made a whole difference. Then I understood the value of dreams, that dreams are the closest to the delusion or the perception level. So I understood that basically the state of being comes from a false perception of reality, which is delusion, and the dream is the closest. And the main thing was not to use the dream as a dream directly, but to understand the perception behind it, the delusion behind it, the experience behind it. Okay. Similarly, the similes and the metaphors and the choice of the words the patient uses for case taking point to his delusion. For example, a patient describing a headache, doctor, the headache is killing me. I want to just finish and destroy this headache. So what is he talking about? So just the metaphor, the way a person uses language, the similes he gives are also part of the delusion. The dreams, the experiences, the similes, the metaphors, and so forth. Here I want to acknowledge the contribution of Dr. M.L. Sehgal, who beautifully interpreted many, many of the symptoms of the repertory. For example, desire for light was his favorite thing. Light, normally we say desire for light is aversion to darkness. But what is the experience of the person in darkness? It's basically the fear of the unknown, isn't it? You don't know what is hiding there. So the patient comes and says, you know, doctor, I don't know what's going on in my stomach. Something is going on. It scares the hell out of me. God knows what is there. I don't know. So he would take this as desire for light. You got it? So that way, he has some beautiful interpretations which I learned from him. And I tried to do something similar also. I also want to acknowledge the contribution of Vitulkas. I invited George Vitulkas to India in 1983. Jayesh and me organized a seminar. And being organizers, we never attended it. You know how it is. If you are organizing, you have so many problems, you can't attend the seminar. So, such a terrible state to be in. But we attended one case. And what was this case? The woman was sitting there and Vitulka asked her, what makes you angry? She says, I can't stand anybody contradicting me. And then there was silence. We are thinking, is the video running or it is stopped? Because both of them are just sitting. What happened? 1 minute passed, 2 minutes passed. You know, 2 minutes in a seminar is a huge amount of time. Normally we would like to ask questions, but he just sat there and watched. And then she said, after 2 minutes of silence, she said, and I want to go and kill the person who does it to me. All of a sudden. So the rubric, kill desire to the person who contradicts. Mercury was given to her. So what I learned from that was the value of silence. That basically we don't have to pump the patients with questions. You have to sit and watch. You must have enough confidence to just sit and watch, and the symptoms will come on their own. That is the beauty. So there's so many things I learned from so many teachers. I'll tell you more. Then I discovered that the rubrics dreams, delusions, fears and delirium can be interchanged. Fear of dog, delusion of dog, dream of dog, very similar. I could use it together to broaden the search. Go next. Then after this come the evolution of the classification. Once I understood that disease is a state of being, comes from a perception, can we classify it? And then I found two ways of classifying. One is according to the desperation of that particular perception, which I called as miasm. And the second is the type of perception. Is it a problem in sensitivity, structure or survival, which I call as the three kingdoms. This is what came next. So traditionally, miasms were considered only three, psoriasis, syphilis and psychosis. But then what I understood was that each miasm represented a type of response. In scabies, the disease would come, it would be intense and it would go. In gonorrhea, it would be more stuck and fixed. And in syphilis, it would destroy you. So there are three types of situations possible broadly. One that is solvable, one that is stuck to you, and one that finishes you. And if these are the three types of responses, our psora, psychosis and syphilis represents this kind of response. So sulfur is hopeful, thuja is fixed, mercury is destroyed.